And what we introduced, so this is a TBCG paper, I highly recommend it. The it published this, actually impressed this year. What we did in short, basically we study how important of a node, the centrality of a node, can influence the importance of other. As simple as that. So with that, we can create some very, very effective visualization. We can use centrality sensitivity to filter the network to give a better overview of the networks. So like here, we have this protein interaction network, which is not big, again, in only 1,500 nodes. But then when you lay it out directly using the conventional layout method, this is what you get. And then we compute the centrality, so the green color represents high centrality. So by using centrality sensitivity, we compute the minimum spanning tree as the core network. And so what we get is a much cleaner network to look at, and then to start the analysis. And what's important here is that the originally central node remains central in this core network. And from here, the analyst can then add certain edges back, right, based on what they want to study. So this is like just one way to deal with size and the complexity. And we apply the same method to other networks. Like here, this is a Friendster social network. And then this is on the right is an astrophysical author network. And on the left, you can see this overview of the network immediately tell us there are several cluster centers, and they influence one another negatively, which indicate that any one of them can become the most important, right? Person or node basically in this network. And the other one, we can see clearly there are two groups of nodes mainly. One is the red is more competitive, and then the other one is more collaborative. Okay. So this is all I want to say about centrality sensitivity methods. And next, I'm just going to mention this very effective graph layout algorithm that we have introduced. This was published at InfoViz a couple years ago, and it's actually used by professional analysts these days. So we provide the layout libraries. And so if you've been working with graph, right, and you know that many graph, if you just lay out directly with a typical force directed layout methods, you often can get hairball like this. So this is a data set that we create, we call California data set. Basically, we do a web search, and then you type you enter the words California, and you get all these pages, web pages, and then you form a network based on the link between all these pages. And it's not big, it's only just over 6,000 nodes. But then it has over 15,000 edges. But when you use high-dimensional embedding method, this is what you get. Not very helpful at all. So we already talked about there's a way you can filter the network. But oftentimes, people want to see the whole network first, right? They want to get some sense about what the whole thing look like. So you need a way to lay out this network. And so again, for the same data set, we use another force directed layout, Linlog method. And this is what we get. Again, not very helpful. And it takes like 10,000 seconds. No kidding. Those of you who have used force directed layout method, you know, it takes forever. And this is not a large graph at all, right? So our method is based on a hierarchical clustering step. After that, we use a space filling curve or use tree map partition. Basically, we try to utilize the screen space or this display space we have as much as possible. And then once we do that, we start seeing structure. And we feel this gives you a good overview of the graph. From here, you can do selection, and then you can drill down, right? And this method is very fast. The layout is very fast. Okay? The expensive part is the clustering. But then for such small data set, okay, we consider this is very small. It only take 1 second to do both clustering and the drawing, the layout. 1 second. But I think if we're talking about several million nodes and larger, then the clustering could take several seconds or maybe minutes. But then after that, you only need to do once. After that, the layout is extremely fast. We also work on time variant network. So we have made some progress. The most recent work will be presented at the graph drawing in September next month. And what we did, our strategy is to pre-process the graph to cluster and order the graph node. And then we have to look at the pair of the consecutive time step and try to associate the cluster, right? And from there, we can enable interactive visualization and enable even random browsing. That, you know, there's some method that people have developed, but then you have to do it from the first time. You have to create a visualization incrementally. Our method allow you to jump to any future time step and then have a picture immediately. So this animation I actually trimmed down because my student make a 2 gigabyte movie for me. I said, it's too big. So I just showed, but this is actually the visualization of internet connectivity over 10 years period. But I only just show you a small subset. But what we try to show here is with our method, it's much easier to follow the evolution of this network, which the different color represent different county, different country. Like green is U.S., I think. Purple is Europe, but I don't know which color is for Brazil. I should have asked my student, but I just give you some idea. Okay, how much time? Oh, I use already almost 40 minutes. That's not good. So. We also get a chance to, let me see, okay. Work on web session data. I'm talking about clickstream data. So we, what happened is I have a student after he got his PhD, he worked for eBay. So eBay, right, there's a lot of users and people go there and then they just, right, they either try to sell or they try to find something they want to buy. So every time when you go to a website, what you do is click, 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 right? So you have this click stream. And eBay want to study their user and in order to serve their user better, right? Because the more business, right, down there on their website, they make more money. So So basically, they archive all this click stream and they want to start it. Okay. And this could be like real-time streaming, but then they actually archive like a daily, and then they study when needed. And so they want to understand their user behavior, and then understand the behavior, how behavior correspond to performance. You know, how successful they become, right? Either they sold something or they bought something, right? And also their demographics, right? They want to know their user as much as possible. So we develop a preliminary method. I don't want to say we have a good solution yet, but then we come up with a way to deal with the data. We do at the beginning use Hadoop, okay, use cluster to first filter the data because there's too much data. We're talking about terabyte, at least terabyte, right? And then how you do interactive visualization on terabyte. So their database support with Hadoop, and then first the analyst would set it up and then play some query, database query to filter the data, and then they will start this interactive visualization process. And so what we do is to first we need to lay out the data, right, on a 2D screen. Okay. And so we can just use something like a self-organizing map. But fortunately, the click string, you know, they all have different length. So we in order to process it effectively, we add a probabilistic model. And then we basically map the click string data as a point to the screen. And then if we draw the click string directly and try to see pattern, because there's each block represent a click, okay? And actually a lot of points, they overlap, right? You can have like 1,000 points on the same pixel. So you get this, right? It picture that which doesn't really reveal the true distribution or the true grouping. And so my student come out a way to remove the overlap is like what you guys did. So I'm not going to go into detail, but then once they do that, they can start, you know, seeing some cluster of click string, similar one. And then the system also allow the user to basically advise the system, the clustering. And then so the user can select a group of click stream and then study, you know, the detail about all this. And then eventually, you know, they will generate like all this cluster. And then for further study, like here they study like how much time users spend on a particular task. Like the users start, like maybe they browse the category or they need to search the category, and then they need to write the description. You know, there's multiple steps they need to do. And so we basically allow the user to interactively align a particular step and then sort it based on amount of time take. So this is the longest. And so here you can see that some of the user, they try very hard. They're probably not familiar with the website. So they spend a lot of time searching information and then they finally give up. Okay, so there's no, like, they don't go to the step to write the description of their product, their stuff, and then they didn't finish the process. But then others, right, they reach the end. And then there's another case here. We align description of the item and then see how this other step affect, how other step correlate with this particular chosen step. So it's just a way that once you can make it interactive, then it become possible that, you know, they can explore data in many ways. I think I should stop here because I talk about this at the St. Carlos anyway, sorry. Let me just stop here because I already used almost 50 minutes. And so, no, I think I can stop. It's because we can just chat and then you guys can go to, if you're interested in some of this work, just go to my website. But basically, big data visualization, exciting area, many new opportunities, and there, you know, all these possible research topics, and others already mentioned a few, but then I just list them again. What I don't want to skip is I want to mention some of this call for paper and participation that I have something to do with. So just want to remind you, Pacific Viz going to be in Sydney. So it's near the end of February. And the paper deadline is upcoming September 26th. Going to remind you here. And then I also run the ultra scale visualization workshop at supercomputing pretty much every year. It's going to be at Salt Lake City, Utah this year, November 12th. This year, we actually plan to produce a proceeding published by, it's going to be on IEEE Digital Library. And the submission deadline is October 1st. If you have any questions, feel free to ask me. For any of this event, feel free to ask me. And LDAF, we started last year and very successful, and we're going to have it again this year. I'm not the chair, one of the chair, but then I would like to promote it. So please go and participate. Maybe there's still a poster deadline. I don't remember, but paper already being selected for the technical program. And finally, we're going to have, right? Gabriel, we will have this, right? big data visualization, special issue of IEEE CGMA. And then tentatively, the submission deadline is November 30. So the issue is in late next year, probably. Okay. So I hope you can contribute to some of this, if not all. So thank you very much. I'm sorry I'm taking extra time here, but yeah, thank you again.
Thank you, Kwon. We have time for questions. Any question?
Thanks for your talk. I would like that you comment a little bit more on importance-based visualization. You showed the flow visualization, and you talked about importance-based. How do you calculate, how do you associate actually importance to part of the data?
So it really depends on the domain. So for developing a good solution, we really want to work closely with the scientists, the people who provide the data, the people who need to utilize the data. And so the importance-based visualization, many others have worked on, right? But essentially, it's based on some sort of importance measure. And then oftentimes, it's like a distance. That's why we, in our case, it's a distant field. So it's distant from what, right? So it's a distant measure. So then, really, for different data, right, different objective, you define what you mean by distant, right? Yes. See if I can find another example. Probably, I'll try to. If I remember, I'll tell you. Yeah.
Question?
Thanks, Kivana, for this nice presentation. And my question is a little bit more technical, let's say. And I would like to understand a little bit better, how do you define centrality in terms of graph? I mean, do you have a kind of density function that from which you compute a kind of...
Yeah, centrality, there's different kind of centrality, depends, right, what are you looking for. So, like, you can just use as simple as degree, right? No degree can be a centrality measure, and then between this and there's other centrality, Markov centrality. So, yeah, it really depends on what you're looking for. And then, but what do we, you know, what we do is to compute the sensitivity of centrality, and then use that, right, as a way to see how some nodes may more influential, you know, and then how influential positively or negatively. and that actually tell you a lot. Thank you.
Thank you, Kwame Weiss.
Thank you.